Thank you, Amanda, and welcome everyone to this program, which is co-sponsored today by the Jewish Federation of Reading and the World Affairs Council of Greater Reading. Before I introduce the speaker, I just wanted to go through some upcoming programs that we have on the agenda. Two that our members already know about and three new ones that have been scheduled. Next week, we have Colonel Benjamin Ogden from the U.S. Army War College, who's going to address us on our newest branch of the Armed Services, Space Force. And all of these presentations are virtual, by the way. So that's next Wednesday, June the 8th. On June the 22nd, we will be privileged to host Dr. Sirian Bustanci with the German Center for Integration and Migration Research at Humboldt University in Berlin, where she is going to address us on the inclusion of refugees into the German educational system, lessons from 2015. She actually brings a unique perspective to this issue because she is of Turkish descent. Her family actually has been living in Germany since the 1960s. They were part of the Gastarbeiter program. So she brings that unique refugee perspective herself to her presentation. And there are two new programs where we now have firm dates. The first is July the 13th. Ross McCallum is going to address us on U.S. International Broadcasting, the Voice of America. He's going to talk to us about the history and current perspective on VOA's role in international television, radio, and social media, with an emphasis on his involvement with VOA concerning its various language groups. And then on August the 31st, we are going to hear from Michael O'Hanlon at Brookings, who's going to speak to us about America's security alliances. We don't yet have a confirmed date, but I have a confirmation from a presenter, Jason Hook, who is a local chef in West Reading, or Sinking Spring, I believe. He recently traveled to Poland as part of a group that assisted in feeding Ukrainian refugees in Poland. And he is pleased to be asked to address us concerning that experience. So we're trying to firm up a date for him in July. Please visit our website often, and hopefully that will appear shortly. So with those programming updates, let us turn to today's presentation, Diversity in Israel. And I'm pleased to introduce today's speaker. Gadeer is the Jewish Agency's first Druze emissary to the United States, where she is based in Washington, D.C. Previously, she was elected to the Knesset as a member of the Blue and White Party, making history as the first Druze woman to become a member of the Knesset. During her tenure, she chaired the Caucus for Planning, Zoning, and Industrial Areas, the Caucus for Advancement of Druze Women, and was a member of several committees. She began working for the Israeli Broadcasting Corporation in 2011, where she hosted a program in Arabic that focused on social and cultural issues concerning Arab youth in Israel. She was selected to host the Israeli Broadcasting Corporation's daily newscast in Arabic. And in 2017, she began anchoring its main Hebrew Saturday evening newscast, becoming the first non-Jewish anchor woman in Israel to broadcast the evening news in Hebrew. She holds a degree with honors in international relations from Haifa University, specializing in negotiations and international relations decision-making. I am pleased to welcome Gadeer to address us this afternoon. Welcome.
Thank you, David. Thank you very much for having me. I'm glad to be today with you. I will share the screen. I will tell my story. We have, I can write a book. I started actually about my life, my positions, my challenges, and things that I believe we should do. But we will have, we will try to have it in, to cover it in 1 hour with Q&A. So I will share the screen. People in Israel ask me who you are. So I say, hello, my name is Gadeer. I am an Israeli, but not a Jew. I am an Arab, but not a Muslim. I am a minority within a minority. My mother tongue is Arabic. My religion is Druze, and I am proud Israeli citizen. Good luck with that. So I believe that I symbolize the real Israel. I symbolize sophisticated, beautiful Israel that have we have a diverse or a rich mosaic full of people from different backgrounds, different languages that share a lot. So I'm glad to represent this diversity here in North America and in the world as a citizen of the world. My father was a contractor. We lived in Daliat el-Karmel. Daliat el-Karmel is the largest Druze village in Israel, located on Carmel Mountain near the city of Haifa. And I remember almost on every Shabbat, every Saturday, we hosted a Jewish family in our home for a dinner or for a lunch because we lived near the market. We have very beautiful market in our village. And many tourists and many Israelis come to visit our village on Saturdays. So as a child, I didn't realize then how much it shaped my personality. Imagine sitting there as a child, eating with the adults, listening to their small talks, to their discussions about Israeli society, about political issues. And we were raised in a way that we, as children, we were raised in a way that you are a social agent. If you have something to say, say it. If you believe something should be changed, go and change it. As a social agent, that you cannot narrow your work or your life, that I care just about my family or about my friends. No, go beyond how I can build my neighborhood, how I can change my city slash village, how I can change my state or even the world. And not as a cliche, as a real way of living. We were very involved, my parents, socially speaking, in even municipal elections. I was, as a child, enrolled in every course or class you can imagine a child can be enrolled in: ballet, performance, painting, tsofim, student councils, delegations. We were very involved in our village, and we were raised in a way that we are not a minority living in the Jewish state. No, we are an integral part of the state of Israel. We had the Day of Independence last month here in DC. We had several ceremonies and official events, and I really miss being there in those days because the connection to the state and the sense of belonging to the state is so strong. I remember on every Yom HaTzma'ut, every Day of Independence, my father decorating the car with the flags, and even he put the flags in the front of the car like a president. It means the sense of belonging and that we are proud Israelis is so strong. And during my life, I was always interested to know more about our history, about our narrative, about our relationship as Druze and Jews. And it's amazing when I started to read more and more and to explore about who we are. I was amazed to see that our relationship as Druze and as Jews started before the establishment of the state. If we talk about the Druze people in general, I don't know how much you know about us. There are 1.5 Druze members in the world. We are a minority living in the Middle East, in Jordan, Syria, Lebanon, and in Israel. In Israel, there are 150,000 Druze members located in 16 Druze villages in three major places, locations: Carmel Mountain, Galilee, and Golan Heights. And the most important thing to know about us, that we have no any territorial or national aspirations. It's not written in our religion that one day we will have our promised own land. That is why we are loyal since day one. Since we were born, you are loyal to the state that you were born in. That is why in some occasions in the past, in wars in Israel, sometimes Druze Israeli soldiers fought against their brothers, Lebanese or Syrian Druze soldiers, because you are loyal at first to the country that you were born in, which is very interesting, very unique to Druze people, unlike other minorities. For example, for Islam, they do have national or territorial aspirations. We do not have. That is why the integration of the Druze is an integration that I believe a successful story of an integration of a minority within a democracy that the state of Israel can be proud of. Today we draft into army in the highest percentage, 82%, the Druze people. It is the highest number in Israel, higher even than the number among the Jewish sector, which is around 74%. And the integration is started among through the path of IDF, but today Druze people are everywhere. Our men, our women, our men in very high ranking positions, in sensitive positions, in IDF, in border police, in sensitive security units, and our women are thriving. Although we are considered to be a conservative or patriarchal society, but modernization or globalization, and we are open up to the world. Sometimes it comes in a delay, but our women today, Druze Israeli women, are everywhere, thriving, succeeding in academy, in all fields. And if we talk specifically about our relationship as Druze and Jews, it's amazing to see that we succeeded to establish very strong bonds, deep trust, even before the establishment of the state. Our leaders, the Druze leaders, realized that there is a similarity between the Druze and the Jews, and we decided to build the state of Israel with the Jewish people, because we believed in the Zionism, in the Zionist aspiration to build a new state in Israel. Look at the photo from 48. I don't know if you know, if you recognize man number 5 in the photo from 48, Yitzhak Sadeh. Yitzhak Sadeh was one of the founders of IDF. In my village, this photo was taken in my village with his Druze friends. They already had very deep trust, fighting together, building the state of Israel. The photo from 56, during the talks about the mandatory military conscription law that was applied for the Druze. The photo from 59, Ben Gurion, the first official visit to Ben Gurion, to a non-Jewish village, to a non-Jewish home, was to a Druze home, Julis, in Julis village, to visit the spiritual leader of the Druze community, Sheikh Amin Tarif. And the photo from 71, I don't know if you recognize the man, the mayor of the city of Haifa, Abba Khushi, in Isfia with Abu Rukn family. Do you remember Shabbat Ashkura, Black Friday, June 46, when Jewish cities were attacked? The Druze people saved Abba Khushi's life, the mayor of the city of Haifa. They protected him. He was hidden by the Druze. He slept for 3 months in Isfia. Isfia is a Druze village. He was hidden, and they protected and saved his life. And today, if you travel to Haifa through Carmel Mountain, through Isfia, a Druze village, you will see that the main road is called Abba Khushi, the name of Abba Khushi, the mayor of the city of Haifa. Can you guess where our national anthem, Hatikva, was written? It was written in my village, in Daliat El Carmel, when Naftali Hertz Amber lived in Lawrence Oliphant's home. Lawrence Oliphant was a Jewish-British diplomat who lived in Daliat El Carmel. He asked the Druze to build his home, and Naftali Hertz Amber lived there, and he wrote Hatikva, our national anthem. Today, it's Beit Yad Labanim, where we commemorate our soldiers, the Druze soldiers, who fell protecting the country, 439 Druze soldiers. So I really, really encourage you, next time you travel to Israel, go to the periphery, meet minorities, go to my village, and don't stop just in eating the delicious food that we have in the market, and the labane, and knafe, and olive oil, and za'atar, which is very delicious, very important, but take a good local guide and go to see how much our past is intertwined, how much we build together the state of Israel. So diving back, going back from the macro to the micro, to me as Gadeer, to my story. My mother remembered me since I was a child. Instead of playing, I was sitting in front of a mirror and broadcasting news and talking to people and interviewing people. And when I was in the sixth grade, 12 years old, I called the manager of a local TV station, and I told him that I want to host a program, a TV program. And he laughed, you know, through the phone, you can see him. I heard him laughing because he told me, you're a child. I told him, okay, but I know what I need to do. And I started, he told me, start to volunteer. And this is what I did in that local TV station. And then I had my own TV program when I was 12 years old. I remember, instead of writing homework, I filmed homework, because I truly believe in people. I truly believe in social involvement and social activism. And I loved my job. When I finished school, I started also media. I was a journalist, an anchor woman. I broadcasted news in Israel in Arabic and then in Hebrew. And some days I broadcasted news in two languages. 7 p.m. Opening news in Arabic, Masa'ul Khair min Urshalim al-Quds. 8 p.m. an hour after that, Erev Tov Lachem Yerushalayim. So it was so, so interesting, and I loved my job. And in January 2019, I received a call from an unknown number. It was morning, I'm washing dishes, listening to podcasts, to news. And it was from Kahol Levan party. They offered me to join politics. And this is not a usual call that you receive during washing dishes. They asked me, can you talk? I said, okay, I'm washing dishes. They said, okay, stop washing dishes. I want to talk to you. I said, okay. And it took me 3 weeks to say yes. They said that we believe that you can be a good representative as a politician. And we are offering you to join us, Kahol Levan party. And it took me 3 weeks to say yes. I already saw what does it mean to be the first to do things. Even when I studied medical imaging, to be the first to be the medical, the ultrasound technician working with men, as a journalist, sometimes sleeping outside the home, high public exposure. I am living in a patriarchal society. It wasn't easy for me to really break glass ceilings. And I knew that now I'm entering a totally new arena, challenging arena. And I have 2 young children. My husband works in a medtech field, actually visit Israel because he traveled a lot. And I lived in the periphery of Israel, Galat El Carmel, a Druze village. It took me 3 weeks to say yes. At the end I said yes. We started a very rushed campaign. It was a huge sensation. It was the first election. Then we didn't know that we will have the second, the third, the fourth, and now maybe the fifth election in Israel. And the first visit of me and Benny Gantz was to the spiritual leader of the Druze community. Benny Gantz called me that day. Can I sit near you on the same sofa? I told him, guess what? I don't know. I am the first to do it. Maximum, we will be killed. I don't know. Let's figure out together. Nobody was killed that day. He sat near me on the same sofa, and I told the spiritual leader of the Druze community, do you remember in 2017 when there was the formal announcement of my appointment as the first non-Jewish anchor woman to broadcast news in Israel? You called me to congratulate me, and you don't know that I cried. I said, yes, we did it. The Druze women, we did it. And I told him, listen, I am 2 years after that, 2019, in your home as a candidate, running for politics as the first woman to do that. So thank you for the trust. I believe you see that there is something strange in this photo. No woman, no women. I am the only woman sitting there. But I told myself, Gadeer, choose your battles. Your existence itself is a huge message for now. But a week after that, I met the all men the party wanted me to work with. Each man from as a representative from each village. And I said, enough is enough. I am giving you homework. Next time, bring any female you know. I started tweeting, posting, talking during interview, calling women to come to talk politics. And then, boom, Druze women came to talk politics. I don't know how much you understand or appreciate what happened then. To bring women to talk or to be involved in political issues, it's amazing, it's wow, and it's much more important than any parliamentary achievement. And it proved to me that yes, we can move societies, yes, we can shape and reshape public opinion if we know how to talk to people, when to talk to people, and where to talk to people. This is in one of the conferences. Nobody divided the hall. You can see that the men sit on the central part, and you can guess which part I love the most, women. So I was elected March 2019, but I'm sure you followed what happened in the political arena in Israel. Our first term, our first cadence was 29 days. Nobody succeeded to form a government. And although it was amazing to be elected, I broke glass ceilings, I broke records, 25,000 votes. But then we had another election, September 2019. Again, nobody succeeded to form a government. And March 2020. And then the leader of my party, Benny Gantz, decided to form a unity government with Netanyahu. But they refused to mention or to put or to ensure in the coalition agreement the amendment in the nation state law. the nation state law was the reason why I decided to enter politics. The nation state law was a basic law that the Knesset legislated in 2018 in order to ensure that Israel is the historic homeland of the Jewish people, which is right. But the state of Israel refused to ensure complete civil equality for all Israelis. And this was the reason why I said yes, this was the reason why I ran for politics. But when Benny Gantz decided to form the government, the unity government with Netanyahu, they refused to add it in the coalition agreements to make the important amendment to ensure equality for all Israelis. So I refused to be a minister. I preferred to be in the opposition. I knew that the government will not last, and it took them half a year till December 2020. So a day after the government was dissolved, I went to Lapid, the leader of my party, then from the opposition, and I told him, like we say in dates, it's me, it's not you. It took me 2 years in politics. Unprecedented crisis, 4 elections. I had 3 elections. In the fourth, I decided not to run, to take time out. And I decided to work in other field. I had several job offers, one of them from JAFI, the Jewish Agency for Israel, to come here to educate, to talk, to do public diplomacy, and to talk about Israel, about minorities, about shared society, about potential, and about challenges. So this is what I do here. And maybe one day I will go back to politics. And through my work, through all those positions in media, in public diplomacy, in politics, this is what I see. The Declaration of Independence, Chapter 13. Israel will ensure complete equality of social and political rights to all of its inhabitants, irrespective of religion, race, or sex. Where are we 74 years after we were established? We need to think carefully about our roles, about our goals, about our agendas, about our vision in a macro perspective for the next century as Israel. So this is what I see. And when I was even in politics, as a representative of the Druze, I didn't limit my work just for Druze or just for minorities. I worked for all Israelis, 9 million. This is how we served in the national law. Level because I truly believe in equality in any state, and history taught us how much it is important to have basic equal rights for all citizens in any state. And I am saying that relying on our uniqueness as a state, relying on our strength and a state of Israel. First thing is, although the domestic challenges that we are facing as Israel, we are still a vibrant democracy. Look what happened a year ago on the 13th of June last year when we had a new government. A new government was formed in Israel. Smooth transition of power. We had unstable 2 years, 4 elections, no budget, no functioning government, no committees. But we succeeded to stabilize the system in a democratic tool, in election. It is important to understand and to appreciate how much we are still a vibrant democracy. We had no 6th of January. We had no military, no troops on ground, no soldiers in streets. We had demonstrations. We succeeded to stabilize the system. What happened when we had the formation of the new government, Netanyahu stood up, went to the seat of the opposition leader. Meanwhile, Bennett came and sat on the seat of the prime minister. Smooth transition of power is something that mustn't be taken for granted. We are a strong economy. Our GDP is 14 times that of Egypt, is 6 times that of Lebanon, it's 8 times that of Iran, it's double than Saudi Arabia. We spend 5% of our GDP on research, more than any other country. We have very strong economy. We are the startup nation, the high-tech empire, the regional superpower. We have military superiority, although the threats, we still control the sky and the sea. And we have new Middle East. Dramatic changes in the Middle East among Israeli society. And we must be aware of that and understand that. And last thing, political changes. Who could imagine Mansour Abbas sitting with Bennett, right and left, Arabs and Jews, forming this government, that this is a crazy government. But it's proving to ourselves at first and to the world that yes, we can. Yes, we can find the mutual path. Yes, we can try to find the goals and to try to work together as right and left and all colors. So relying on all those things, I understand that we are very, very strong state, politically, socially, and economically, yeah. Our hope and our tools, some of the tools that I saw and I believe we should implement as Israel. Most important tool when we are talking about shaping public opinion is education. Education, education, education. Education is a key, education is a tool. When we arrived here, we moved to the US last July. And I came with my family. I have two children, my youngest, 7 years old, Liam. And one weekend during hiking here in the Great Falls, I called him in Arabic, Liam, shway shway. He was hiking and I wanted him to slow down. And shway shway in Arabic, it means slowly, step by step. A man who was nearby, he told me, hello, shway shway, Arabic, Morocco. I said, no, Israel. He said, what? Don't you say Palestine? I said, no, we are Israelis. We live in Israel. He said, what? People speak Arabic in Israel? There are Arabs in Israel? I was shocked. I was shocked. It was the first time that I understand that sometimes basic details, basic info, sometimes people don't know that. Sometimes it became so trendy to criticize Israel, even without knowing where Israel exists on the map. Who is living in Israel, the numbers, the facts, the basic details. So education is not a cliche, it's a real way of working, to educate ourselves. By the way, it's true about any topic. This is how I educate my children. Before developing, before having any stance, any opinion towards anything, any topic, let's educate ourselves. Let's dive, let's explore and read and know more about this topic and then tell me what you think about it. And it's amazing to see how much the lack of knowledge, how much that superficial agendas today are so deep. So please, this is the most important tool to educate ourselves. Sometimes I ask people, who is the agriculture minister of Israel? In a way of when we care about something, it is important to know about it. What is happening there in Israel? Researchers found that you will take home with you and you will remember just 17% of what I said now. So please just take this sentence. It is less than 17%. Don't talk about them. Talk to them. Talk with them. When you want to know about minorities in Israel, talk with minorities. When you want to know about Circassians living in Israel, go and to Kfar Kama. Meet them. Absorb the atmosphere. Eat their food. Talk to them. Ask them what they feel, what they need, what they worry about, what are their current challenges. When you want to know about shared society in Israel, go to Jaffa, go to Haifa, meet Christians and Jewish people and talk to them directly. And I put in the middle the photo of the Druze and the Jews together because we believe that IDF is a melting pot in Israel. When people serve in army, when they speak to each other, when they sleep in tents, and fighting Hezbollah in Maidun, it's a very intensive, very strong experience in which people talk to each other, speak to each other. So that is why we know each other. Unlike two sectors in Israel, and I put it here in the sides, the Arabs and the Jewish religious Haredi sector, who less talk as collective, as groups, they less talk to each other. They live in Israel geographically in different places. They work, they study in different places. And we are working so hard to encourage them as collectives to speak to each other, to have more initiatives, more joint programs, to make them know each other. Sometimes people ask me, do we have shared society in Israel? I say, yes. Is it enough? No, we need to work harder to have it. The need to change terminology. The relationship between the Druze and the Jews in Israel is called Brit Damim, covenant of blood. That since the mandatory military conscription law was applied for the Druze, we have the covenant of blood. We are fighting together. And I said we need to replace it. No covenant of blood, covenant of life. Lo brit damim, brit chayim. I am not coming to die with you. I am coming to live with you. as an equal citizen, and I wrote about it in Haaretz in 2020, that equality must be implemented everywhere, not just in IDF, in the high-tech office, in the grocery store, in the train, everywhere. And I am the eighth generation living here, in that land. And as I said, I am not a threat. I have no territorial or national aspirations. I am coming to live with you as an equal citizen. So sometimes, as I cannot accept people telling me, just a moment, after the nation state law, why I should go to army if I am considered to be B-class citizen. I said, no, you are not doing any favor to anybody by going to army. You are protecting your son and your home and my home and our state. As I cannot accept that, I cannot accept people who sometimes tell me, you know what, be grateful to be born in Israel as a minority and not to be killed or massacred in a Syria, in a terror attack. No, I am here to live with you as an equal citizen. So no brit damim, brit chayim, covenant of life, living together. We go back, apropos talking about terminology. I found myself some days fixing speeches of leaders in Israel who said, Jews and non-Jews, Yehudim v'she'inam Yehudim, you cannot identify, you cannot define me by saying I am not or none something. Imagine Biden in the US is giving a speech and saying that we care about Christians and non-Christians. You have a name. So it's not none something. Each one of us has a name. Israeli Arabs, not what you think. I lectured in one of the synagogues 2 months ago, and the woman came to me and she told me that they were in Israel one day a couple of years ago, and they were on a jeep tour and they saw the tents where Druze people live. And I, where to start? I don't live in tent. 21st century, I don't live in tent. And she was young, educated woman who studied in Columbia University in New York. And when she told me that, I said to myself, wow, where to start? How she thought that I live in tent. So Israeli Arabs are not what you think. Those are not primitive tribes living in tents. Those are amazing people, educated people. Today, half of the doctors in Israel are Arabs. And the young generation is young leaders who are aware, who understand their duties, their roles, and we need, as the state of Israel, to strengthen their sense of belonging as Israelis. So next time you travel to Israel, don't stop in Jerusalem, Hakotel, Tel Aviv. Go to the periphery, meet minorities, know better who is living in Israel. It's very important to understand that. And this, some call it non-Jewish sector, this Arab sector is a heterogeneous sector. We have Bedouins, Christians, Muslims, Druze. Even we can dive more among the Bedouins. Bedouins who are living in the north of Israel are totally different than the Bedouins living in the south of Israel. Some of those living in the south of Israel, in the Negev, some of them still live in tents. Those are living in homes. Totally different way of living. Totally different challenges. So always dive more deep, understand who is living in Israel. Highlighting the beauty. Those photos, highlighting the beauty as a tool. Those photos were taken on the 30th of April last year. On the 30th of April last year, we had the Har Miron crowd crush. 45 Jewish worshippers were killed. Those people were waiting to help their Jewish brothers who were injured that day. Those photos were taken from Tamra, a Muslim city in the Galilee. They brought bottles of water, anything they had, and they called the Jewish people, come, we are here waiting for you to help you, to help our Jewish brothers. 3 years ago, we had floodings in Nahariya. Jewish people lost their stores, their restaurants. Arabs from Mazra, a tiny village near Nahariya, people took their tractors and came to help their Jewish brothers. And like those initiatives from Arabs to help Jewish people, we have dozens from the Jewish sector to help the Arab sector. This is real Israel. This is Israel that I saw. This is Israel that I believe in. There is no racist society. Society is what you feed as a leader. And this is the positive face of Israel, full of people who are different but share common values. When I finished school, I started studying my BA at Bar-Ilan University, and it was a very intensive program from 8 to 8. And I slept for 3 years in a friend of my parents' home, a Jewish, amazing Jewish Iraqi woman who opened for me her home and her heart and treated me like I was her daughter. It's amazing to see the relationship between people in the level of individuals. This is real Israel that we had. I need to share the voice, just a moment. Now you can hear it.
احنا موجودين بمتحف يهود مرحبا بكم بصفحة إسرائيل باللهجة العراقية. اليوم نحن موجودين بمتحف يهود بابل وتحديدا بمدينة أور يهودا بدولة إسرائيل. وكعضو كنيسة دعيت اليوم للقاء بضعة الأشخاص والإلقاء محاضرة. وسررت جدا بلقاء يافا مساسة اللي هي بالنسبة لي مش بس صديقة إنما أم. أثناء لقب الأول درست بجامعة بار إيلان وكوني أنتمي للطائفة المعروفية وأنتمي لمجتمع محافظ أهلي اختاروا لإلي أو كان بدهم يختاروا لإلي أن أكون بمحل اللي حافظوا علي فأنا نمت 3 سنوات عند يافا مساسة اللي كانت بالنسبة لإلي كأم حنونة كل يوم تعتني بي وتحافظ علي وتوديني هي شخصيا على الجامعة وترجعني من الجامعة وتعطيني زوارتي معها فهي دلالة على العلاقات الخاصة المميزة الموجودة عندنا في دولة إسرائيل بين العرب وبين اليهود بدون أي تمييز نفتخر بدولة إسرائيل.
So the foreign ministry were there and they asked us, it was a, we had a reception for a secret, it was then secretive delegation from the Gulf States and we had it in the Jewish Iraqi Museum in Or Yehuda and the foreign ministry were there. They wanted us to film that short clip. They have a beautiful initiative, a Facebook account. They target Arabs from the Middle East, Israel تتكلم بالعربية, 1 million followers. And they wanted us to have this short clip talking about Shir Society that we have in Israel. One of the tools we talked about highlighting the beauty and other tool, which is very important, also the ability to talk about Israel warts and all. We are robust enough, strong enough, brave enough, honest enough as Israel, as a state, as a society, as communities, to bring the diversity, the complexity, not just to beautify things. It's so important tool when we seeking to have deep engagement for the long term. It's important to talk about the complexity. Israel is a very, very complicated state and we cannot just highlight the beautiful faces, the positive faces. Part of my position is working with Hillel International, campuses, universities, very challenging arena. We are losing students and we cannot anymore come with this patronage up bottom. I call it Kim Jong-un advocacy, absolute advocacy, love us, we are pink, we are gold, we are absolutely right. No, it doesn't work anymore. We work very hard to have this, to build the trust, to be able to talk about the complexities, to say, yes, sometimes we do mistakes, we are not perfect as a state, and to listen to each other and to have meaningful dialogues about who we are as Israel. I believe that this is very, very strong, strong and important tool when we are talking about educating communities. And when we are talking about complexity, this photo was taken on the 4th of August 2018. It's a rally that my community, the Druze community, arranged against the nation state law. By saying we have no problem with what was written in the law, we know that Israel is the historic homeland of the Jewish people. We have a problem with what was not written in the law, ensure equality. So people were there. At the end of that rally, we stood up singing Hatikva, our national anthem. We respect our national anthem, although we don't exist there as minorities. And I was there covering the event live for IPBC, the Israeli Public Broadcasting Corporation. And hearing people, listening to people who were chanting Shivyon, Shivyon, Shivyon. Shivyon means equality. And those are the demands. Kamal wanted to protest by wearing half IDF uniform and half white t-shirt, by saying that when I am a soldier, I am considered to be A-class citizen in the Jewish state. When I go back home to my village and see the gaps, I feel how much I am B-class citizen. So when we are talking about complexity, it is important to understand the challenges, the current challenges among minorities in Israel about sense of belonging. We need to work much more hard to strengthen the sense of belonging, to close the gaps. The good news is that we already do that. We work so hard in Israel, and we did in politics and in different places, in parliament, in government, to close the gaps, to strengthen our social resilience. You can see that the new budget in the new government, they doubled the budget. Instead of 15 billion for Arab sector, it's 15 billion. I'm sure you heard about the crime wave. 126 Arabs were killed last year under this unprecedented crime wave, half of them under age 30. So the new government put more budget, more money, 2.4 billion shekel, more units, more police offices and stations in the villages to defeat the crime. And another challenge, if we are talking about minorities, is planning and building illegal buildings. Israel woke up in 2017 realizing that there are 100,000 illegal buildings, the majority of them among the Arab sector. It's a huge issue, we will not talk about it, but in general, in one example, in every city or village you have in Israel, the blue line. We talked about Isfia, the Druze village. Last time the blue line was extended in 1978, which means anything you build beyond the blue line is considered to be illegal. And people, when they try to build their own homes on their own lands, good luck with bureaucracy. It's illegal. So it's another challenge. We succeeded through politics to freeze Kamenetz law, to have the electricity law. We had it last month. We are working so hard to fix this challenge too. Last tool, social activism. Do you remember what my father told me? If you have something to say, say it. The children in this photo are mine, Tom and Liam, from last May. You cannot sit on the sofa, watch TV, go out. And we were reminding people that we are brothers. People were killing each other in the street, in Haifa, in Jaffa, because of religion. And we just wrote, we are brothers, and talked to people, and I posted and tweeted. And it's so important those days, and so easy those days to be a journalist, to be active, socially active, by tweeting, posting, filming, sharing. You know, as a social agent, each one of us has many identities and a story to tell to the world. So share your stories, share what you believe in, and let us celebrate the diversity that we have in Israel. Look at me, a Druze Israeli woman living in DC, representing the Jewish Agency of Israel. And I believe that each one of you is a unique story, a unique identity, a complex of identity, and it is important to be involved citizens and active, socially active. And I will end up with the story of Zidane Seif. Zidane Seif was a Druze policeman, Druze brave policeman. He was killed in 2014 in a terror attack. There was a massacre in Bnei Torah synagogue in Har Nof in Jerusalem. He saved lives of Jewish worshippers that day, and he was killed. And one day when I was in the Knesset, in the parliament, I was working at night, and my assistant approached me and she said that we received an email from a Jewish philanthropist. He wanted to donate money for the Jewish community, and he wanted me to connect him to lay leaders in my community. And I invited him to my office. I thanked him. I told him, you don't need to donate money. You don't need to thank us for drafting into army. This is our duty. This is our role. We are not doing any favor to anybody. But he just wanted me to connect him. I connected to the widow of Zidane Seif. His widow, she set up a fellowship to support Druze students. And when I traveled back home, I told my assistant, what an amazing story. This story symbolized for me more than anything else the story of Israel. Imagine with me, Joseph, a Jewish philanthropist, living in New York City. He is thinking about how he can strengthen the social resilience, how he can close gaps in Israel. With the help of me as a Jewish female sitting in the Israeli parliament, trying to help the widow of Zidane Seif, who was killed trying to protect the Jewish worshippers. And his widow is trying to support Druze student. Look at this circle. This circle is Israel. It proved to me that at the end of the day, it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter where do you live. at the end of the day, all of us care. And even it's beyond I care, I love, I cherish my state. It's commitment. It's dedication. We are all working so hard to build the bridges, to connect people, to build the trust, to initiate joint programs, to make people to talk to each other. And I'm so proud and so glad to be part of this work in the name of diversity, in the name of inclusion, and in the name of equality. Thank you so much. I believe we have 10 minutes for Q&A.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you.
I have some questions already in the chat. If you are interested in asking questions, please feel free to put it into the chat. Our first question, Gadeer, comes from Bill. He asked about the population chart that you showed. Does that include the West Bank and Gaza?
No, it's just among Israelis.
Okay. He also asked about the relationship between the Druze and then the Shiite and Sunni Muslim communities.
Our religion was originated 1,000 years ago in Egypt. It derived from Islam, Shia Islam, but we separated ourselves. So our religion is not connected. That is why sometimes we cut in the, not sometimes, we cut in the middle as Druze. Some Jews may see us as Arabs. By definition, when your mother tongue is Arabic, you are an Arab. Although the component, the Arab component in my identity less exists. I feel, although my mother tongue is Arabic, I think in Hebrew, I live in Hebrew. And even I realized in Israel, how in DC, how much I am connected to Israel. When I make friends, new friends are Israelis. I am in WhatsApp groups of Israelis. I go to Israeli stores. It's amazing to see the connection, how much it's strong. So although by definition I am an Arab, the Arab component in my identity less exists. So I am cut in the middle. Some Israelis may see me as Arab, and Arabs, especially Palestinians, see us as betrayers. Why you are so pro-Israeli? And they don't understand that my history, my narrative is totally different to their own one. They are talking about Nakba, about being uprooted, about what happening to them. It didn't happen to me. Our leader decided to fight and to build the state of Israel, to be integral part of the state of Israel. So sometimes we cut in the middle, and it's very complicated. You know, you're a minority in a majority, in a minority in a majority, but I see it as uniqueness. I see it as authenticity, to be able to understand the languages, not just the languages, the nuances, the people, and to be a bridge to make people understand each other. And it is amazing to see how much we do it here, even among interfaith committees and groups, to make people, in some of the groups in Hillel, we work with students, Jews and non-Jews, to talk about Israel, new Israel, real Israel, as a minority, as a periphery, as a woman. It's very interesting.
Thank you. I have a comment from Anita. Haifa is a beautiful, vibrant international city, and it's also home of the beautiful Baha Gardens and home of one of the most holy sites of the Baha faith, just kind
Correct.
Of throwing out, yeah.
Correct.
The diversity. Question from Randall, can or should Israel eventually form one state, including Palestinian land such as the West Bank, or is a two-state solution better?
No one state. When you dive and understand the ramifications of each decision, you understand that we, when we want and seek to survive as a state in the next centuries, as the state of Israel with a Jewish majority, we cannot allow ourselves to have one state. You know, it sounds so beautiful. I am a mother of children. I would like to have this one open land for all of us, but it's so complicated. And once you have a one state, there will be, even by numbers, you will see it, there will be no any more majority of the Jewish people. So we must have separation. We can call it two states, three states, confederation, state minus. There were many creative plans and offers, but we must have separation. If we want to continue as our identity, as the Jewish state, as the homeland of the Jewish state, we cannot just open it for everybody with millions of Arabs and Palestinians. There will be no any majority of the Jewish people anymore.
Thank you. What do you say to people who criticize the Israeli government for not being diverse and not taking care of, particularly the Palestinian people in Israel. What do you have to say about that as a minority within a majority country?
I did that already as a member of parliament. And some people less understand or less aware of the two levels. It means when I was member of parliament, I criticized the government as an opposition. And it's very important tool as a citizen, not just as a leader, to be very involved, to understand what is happening in our state, and to criticize and to demonstrate and to share our voices when it is needed. I did that and I still do that because I love my state and I want my state to be aware of its steps and what it's doing. But in other level, we all understand that in the international or in the macro perspective, we are not perfect state. And this is what I am trying to convince or to make people understand. Imperfection is part of dealing with countries or managing countries. There is no perfect country in the world, not in the modern era, not in the past. We are working so hard. We are a young state, 74 years old. We are working so hard to look what we have. We have independent free press and media, independent judiciary system. We have the strong base as a democracy, but we are not perfect, and we are working so hard to have it in Israel. And this government, I believe, although the complexity, although this is a crazy government, you know, it is show us that yeah, we are still good country. We have many mistakes that we do. We did mistakes. We still do mistakes. And as long as the conflict still exists, it is bad for us. But guess what? It's not just our fault. It's very complicated place to live in. And sometimes people less understand the complexity of what is happening in the field. So what I say is that, yes, I am not saying we are perfect. I am not telling you love us, absolutely love. And some people are afraid from criticism. No, I say that you criticize when you care. Once you stop criticizing me, then I will be afraid. And you criticize when you care, by the way, even in the individual level with my children, I criticize them when I care about them. Once I don't care, so do anything you wish to do. So to criticize, it's a very important tool. And we found that one of the challenges when we work with students, that somebody told them that you cannot express yourself freely, you cannot ask, because if you say something wrong, so you don't love Israel. What Trump said 3 months ago, in those words, Jewish communities in North America, they don't love anymore, they don't care anymore about Israel. Wrong. You can criticize when you care. And it's important for me to listen to you. It's important for you to share your voice. It's important to me to share my voice. At the end of the day, to have table and room for all of us to sit, to talk, to think, to rethink, and to have meaningful discussions and constructive dialogues about who we are, what are our aspirations, and what we need to think. And this is Israel. Our ability to fix and to understand and to change things, this is the strength of Israel.
Thank you. Another question, you mentioned about the relationship between the Jewish community and the Jewish community. How does the Jewish community get along with the other minorities within the state of Israel? Other religious minorities?
So we have very good relations, but as I said, we cut in the middle. Some Muslims in general, if we are talking about religion aspect, the fact that our religion derived from Islam, Shia Islam, they less connect to the religion as a religion. Socially speaking, the fact that we draft into army, that we are fighting in IDF, that we are protecting the country. For example, the 2 months ago, during the terror attacks that we have last wave, one of the victims was a Druze soldier. And Palestinians celebrated his death. They prefer to kill a Druze soldier rather than a Jewish soldier, because for them, it's a, you know, common sense. The Jewish soldier is fighting for his land. Why the Druze? We are fighting for our state, the state of Israel that we are part of. So it's very complicated. Socially speaking, we succeed. We have very good relationship with all other minorities. This is something, by the way, that very unique to Druze as a collective, very kind people. In the Middle East, we are very, very well known of our very unique kind relations with other minorities and our loyalty. We are the loyalist minority in Israel. So it's complicated, but we learn how to live through it, through this complexity.
Well, thank you so much, Yadir, for joining us today and teaching us so much about the Jewish community and about Israel and your politics. I know I learned a lot today, and I hope the rest of the group did too. Keep posted. Our next World Affairs event is next Wednesday. You can visit our website to learn more about those events and other upcoming events this summer. Thank you again, and have a great day,
Amanda. Thank you, Amanda.